Hallelujahs.
Yes.
So we want to remember that this morning as we stand and we go into prayer. Amen. Holy, compassionate Father, we give you praise, we give you honor and glory for you, for who you are.
Jesus.
Because in you all things were created, and we exalt you, Lord. Father, we surrender our lives to you in worship and praise, for you alone are worthy. We invite you, Holy Spirit, to move freely in this service this morning. To come dwell in our hearts. And we ask that you equip us to challenge us, to comfort and to teach us. We acknowledge you in all things and trust you with our whole hearts. We lean not unto our own understanding or our own ways, but we completely confidence is in you. We acknowledge your presence in this place. You are the God of every moment, and we desire your goodness. You alone are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the first and the last, and we praise you, Lord. For you are a mighty, mighty God.
Yes.
We thank you this morning for the gift of life that we might serve you. And we thank you for your mercies that are brand new every morning, for our do-over opportunity. We thank you that you are the creator of the universe, the everlasting Father, the one and only true God.
Yes, God.
We pray that as we open our hearts to you, as we focus our minds on you, and as we fix our eyes to you, that we will see you for who you are in all your glory. Father, reveal yourself to us more and more.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you that you are the author and finisher of our faith, the protector, that you will give us love, and Father, that you call us your friend. We worship you in spirit and in truth, and we magnify you and we lift you up. We are so grateful that you dwell in this place, that you make this habitation here in this holy location, that you have chosen to consecrate this great house and to put your name. Father, fill this place with your glory. And we thank you for the worship service today, for a fresh anointing that will fall on this place, for the angels
God.
That are ascending and descending, receiving and executing in this earth, Father. We are so grateful to
you. Thank you, Lord.
And Father, we thank you that you loved us so much that you've given us the set angels of this house, the shepherds, Apostle Johnny L. McGee Jr., and for our beautiful First Lady, Lady L. Thank you that they are committed to preaching and teaching your word always with a heart of love and with great boldness and with great clarity. We are grateful, Father, for the anointing that rests upon their lives, and that you will continually walk before them, illuminating their paths as great signs, miracles, and wonders follow them. We lift their families to you. Father, thank you for keeping them in your care and allowing the sweet peace to encompass all of them. And Father, as we yield and surrender to you, have your way in this worship service.
God. Thank you,
thank you for the members of this house family as they start to gather, and for the people that are coming from the north, the south, the east, and the west. Father, they are coming to connect with you. They are coming seeking your presence. They are coming seeking your deliverance. They're coming seeking salvation, Father, and we pray and we thank you that they will find it here. Thank you that they will know that you are our refuge and our fortress, that you are our strong tower, and that we can run into and be safe and secure always.
Yes.
You
Hallelujah.
Are our sustainer.
Hallelujah.
We thank you for your word that will come forth today, that your word is living and powerful, that your word is sharper than any two-edged sword, and that it will do what you send it to do. For the great exchange, Father, we thank you for the beauty for ashes. We pray that today everyone will hear your word and that every need will be met. So as we hear your word, give us the heart to be doers of the word and not just hearers. Father, we love you. We thank you for anchoring our souls firm and secure. And we bless your holy name, for it's all about you, Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen and amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We thank you. Well, we want to welcome our streaming family this morning here at the house. We are so excited to be here. This is a good place to be this morning, you know? It's an awesome place to be. And God has allowed us to be here. So we welcome our streaming family this morning. and our first time Vic guest. Amen. And so we want to go into Psalm 91 this morning. But we want to go into Psalm 91 this morning. And we're going to decree what God has already declared over our lives. This is big. Psalm 91 is huge. He has kept us. Y'all understand that we have been through a pandemic and we're still standing. God is awesome. And this is our protection, our canopy of protection. And if that don't give you motivation to praise God, I don't know what will. Amen? Amen. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder. The young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation.
Come on and bless the name of the Lord this morning. Come on and open up your mouth and give God some praise, for this is the day that the Lord has made. And we all shall rejoice and be glad in it. I'm glad you're here, where you're viewing, where you're standing, where you're sitting. Come on and open up your mouth and give God some praise this morning. For He is Lord of all. He is ruler of nations. He is God of all the earth. And we come to give Him praise, glory, and honor this morning. Come on, let's worship Him in the house this morning. Hallelujah, let's do it. Come on. Come on and clap. Our God is awesome and He's greatly to be praised, yeah. Come on, let's sing this song together.
Lord of all the earth,
let all your people pray.
Let all the give you the glory. I was made to give you the honor. I was made to give you the praise, praise, praise. I was made to give you the glory. I was made to give you the honor. I was made to give you the praise, praise.
Tennis, come on, hey!
I was made to give you the glory. I was made to give you the honor. I was made to give you the praise.
Inside. We thank you for dying for us, Jesus, so that we can be free, so that we can be whole, and so that we can be light, so that everyone in the world will know that we are your child. We thank you, oh God. We bless your name. Come on, lift your hands in the house. think you're free this morning. Oh, come on, you know you're free, yeah. Oh, we are free. We are set free by His blood, by His mercy. We are free. It is by His mercy we are not consumed. Lord, we give you praise. Praise the Lord, we are free.
Hallelujah. 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 Let's bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. Let's bless the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. He thought we were worth saving. Amen. He went to the cross and shed His blood. And now God looks at that blood. He doesn't see my filthy rags. He sees the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
And it
Amen.
Gives me access. Yes, and He cleans me up inside, and I'm to living for Him now. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! It's a mighty God. It's a mighty God that we serve. Hallelujah!
Amen.
Hallelujah!
So welcome again, House Church. How you guys doing? Good. Do we have any first-time guests this morning? We just want to acknowledge you. Yes, sir. Just raise your hand.
Hallelujah.
Okay.
Praise God.
And thank you. Thank you. We just want the... okay, I'll see you, sir. House Church, let's give our first-time guest a very, very special welcome
yes.
this morning. All right. Good morning. So, you know, it's that time of the service where it's opportunity for prosperity.
Yes, yes.
And that's
Hallelujah.
Our time for giving of our tithes and our offerings.
Oh, come on. Don't pancake.
So,
come on.
So if you're in need of a tithes and offering envelope, just raise your hand and the porters are standing in the aisles waiting to receive you.
Hallelujah.
And so while you're preparing your tithes and offering and waiting on that envelope, sir, that... just pay attention to the, and there's several ways that you can give here at the House Church, either by our website or either the, and it'll be up on the screen for you, but our church website, you'll see that, or you can just put it in the envelope, stick it out in our mailbox, and then we have an app that's called Givelify, and it's tap, give, done. It's real easy. And you can download that, and you can give that way as well. And then for those that are in the live service here, you can come right up front and just put your offering into the buckets that'll be sitting down just down below us here in just a second. So as you prepare for your tithes and offering, pay attention to the screens and find out all the wonderful things that are happening here at the House Church. And be blessed, and we'll be back. All right.
On behalf of our pastors, Apostle and Lady L, welcome home to the House Church, where we're connecting God's house to your house. Great morning. I'm Eldris Kemp, and here's what's happening at the house. It's great being back together in the house, and our goal is to remain safe while we worship. Weekly sanitation is done throughout the building, and temperature checks and sanitizing stations are available upon entering. Although masks are optional, please keep in mind the latest CDC recommendations, and let's all do our part to protect each other as we continue to fellowship and worship. Have you downloaded the House Church app? If not, what are you waiting for? The House Church app gives you the ability to stay connected with all that is going on right here at the house. And that's not all. Once downloaded, sign up for alerts so you can be informed immediately when we live stream, have special events, and so much more. So, get connected and download the app today. There are many wonderful ministries here at the house for you to serve in. How do you join a ministry? I'm glad you asked. All you have to do is complete the Ministry of Helps application located on the House Church app under the House Church Ministries tab. Or you can stop by the Welcome Center after today's service and pick up an application. It's time for a celebration. We will kick off our Pastor Appreciation Apostolic and Consecration Weekend with a concert featuring Anthony Brown and Group Therapy. There will be blessings on blessings because this concert is free and open to the public. So invite your friends and family and meet us here on Friday, October 1st at 7 p.m. But get this, it doesn't end there. The celebration will continue on Sunday, October 3rd at 10 a.m. during the Apostolic Affirmation and Consecration Service. Join us as we celebrate the elevation of Apostle McGee and welcome our guest speaker, Pastor Valerie Holcomb of the Christian House of Prayer, Killeen, Texas. We look forward to seeing you all here for this wondrous occasion and celebration. There's a lot going on here at the House Church. Be sure to get involved and join in on what's happening. Remember our weekly services. Sunday morning service is at 10 a.m. Wednesday night service is at 7 p.m. And intercessory prayer is on Saturdays at 9 a.m. For all the latest news and updates at the House, please download our app and sign up for alerts. You can also visit our website at www.thehousechurch-va.org. There's a lot going on at the House Church, so be sure to get involved and stay connected. Thank you for worshiping with us today. We pray that you'll enjoy the service and have a blessed week.
Amen. Amen.
We got a celebration coming up in October, y'all.
You make sure that you get your reservation and come on in. But we're looking forward to each and every one of you for our pastor celebration, for his apostolic consecration. I told you we was coming back, didn't I? Y'all was worried a little bit, wasn't you? Where are they coming back?
We got training wheels on y'all.
Yeah.
It's all right.
So if you would allow me just a couple minutes, I got a story to tell you. 40 years ago, when me and my wife got married.
That's a long time.
Thank you. When me and my wife got married, I had a lot of bills. And come to find out, my wife had a lot of bills. So between the two of us, we had billses. Can y'all say that? Billses. Yeah.
That's Tennessee for we broke. Broke.
Yeah. And so over the course of time, it wasn't that long, but we had heard a teaching about tithes and offering. And I had never heard that. As many years I've been, grew up in a church as a little kid, my wife and I, we went to the same church there for a little while, and they never mentioned the word tithe. They mentioned the word offering, but there was never a teaching on offering that would explain to you the benefits of giving your tithes and offering. So we didn't know. But once you know better, you do better, right?
Yes, yes.
So after we learned that, we got down, we prayed, and we had a revelation from God on how to come out of our debt. And we had to go through the 7 year where you can't get no credit and none of that stuff. We had to do
that. They locked the door when they saw us coming.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I don't know if they, I had never heard of the credit score at that time. So we probably didn't even have a credit score. If so, it might have had a minus sign in front of it. So we was doing
bad.
Real good. But after we started tithing and we made the sacrifice.
There was
a lot
amount.
Of things, the real amount. We wasn't not the play amount. It's the whole 10%.
Off the gross.
Yeah. And that's off the gross, right? Amen. Because there wasn't much left after that. After Uncle Sam got his, there wasn't much left. But we made that sacrifice, and we made that deliberate decision to start tithing. And it's really made a difference in our lives. And after 40 years, that is still working. So the Word of God works, doesn't it? The Word of God works. And so so moving on, we've never lacked for anything. And we got two kids through school.
House?
Yeah, the house, yeah. Everything that we ever needed, we always had more than enough. Amen. So if you have not tried it, just know that the Word of God works, okay? And it's and God is faithful in His Word and all His promises concerning the tithe. If you would, please, go with me to Deuteronomy 15, and we'll just start there in verse 10. And there's two best-kept secrets in God's Word, if you didn't know it. But there's two best-kept secrets that most people don't know about. But I'm going to share it with you. So in Deuteronomy 15, verse 10, it says, "Give generously to them and do so without a grudging heart. Then because of this, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in everything you put your hand to do." Basically, what that means is that givers never lack. Just in case you didn't know that, but givers never lack. Whatever you need, it's always going to be there. And then let's look at Luke 6:38. It also says, "Give generously." That's pretty neat, isn't it? It says, "Give generously, and the generous gift will be given back to you, shaken down to make room for more. Abundant gifts will pour out upon you with such an overflowing measure that it will run over the top." Your measurement of generosity becomes the measurement of your return.
Come on. That's it.
And so the second thing that we see here, or the second best-kept secret in the Bible, is it talks about over and above giving. And that equals over and above living, which is why we never lack, because we never gave just 10%, except
in the beginning.
In the very beginning.
The gross amount was pretty gross then, too. That was, yeah. It was hard. It was hard. But then you got used to it, and it flowed. And God just supplied, and He just kept supplying. And you keep being thankful and grateful, and He kept supplying.
Yeah. Yep. Amen. That's true. So we've always given more than the 10%, which is why we've never lacked anything, because, again, God is faithful to His Word, and whatever you need, it's going to be there. So that our barns are full and kids are fed and we're fed, right? I don't think we ever missed a meal yet either. No, I don't think so either. Okay. Amen. Okay, so if you receive that, stand to your feet. And just remember that God is always with you. He will never let you down.
You're right, sir.
And God is faithful, Elder Mack.
Amen.
God is faithful. So Heavenly Father, we just thank You for this day. We thank You that You are the giver of all things, Father God. Lord, we know that everything that we have is because of You. And we thank You, Father. Your Word says that if we give, we will receive. And we will receive abundance that will be overflowing, Father God. That whatever bucket that we have need of, Father God, it will always be filled. If we need health, Father God, if we need healing, Father God, You will send that to us as well. Whatever it is that we need in our life, physically, emotionally, spiritually, socially, and physically, Father God, that You will provide. And we always put You first in each and everything that we do. We thank You for the first time tither on this morning, who will come to the realization, as we have 40 years ago, that Your Word works. Lord, we thank you for all these things and for each person here today that will be blessed to give. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Okay, let's do our church confession because we believe it, right? We say it loud and proud. Okay, ready? Read. People are standing in line to get into this church to hear the word of God. We speak to the north, south, east, and west, commanding them to give up and to keep not back, bringing the sons and daughters of the house from near and far. There is a person in every seat, and our sanctuary is filled to its capacity in every service with an expectation of signs, wonders, and miracles. Our Sunday morning service at 10 a.m. is filled. Our Wednesday night service at 7 p.m. is filled. And any other service that we may have will be filled. Every need in this ministry is met above and beyond what is required, and we are 100% tithe givers. All of our properties are paid off in full, and we owe nothing to no man but to love them. We declare that every member of this church is healed, healthy, blessed, and prosperous, and we are reaching the world with the gospel through our prayers and financial support. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ, and because we walk by faith and not by sight, our vision comes to pass, and the door of failure has been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ, and because we walk by faith and not by sight, our vision comes to pass, and the door of failure has been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ, and because we walk by faith and not by sight, our vision comes to pass, and the door of failure has been closed, and we shall not know defeat. And being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform, because it's all about Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen. It's all about him this morning, and we believe that this week and every day will be a week of blessings upon our lives. Come on, let's lift them up this morning. Here we go.
I cannot explain it. This may not make sense. I know what it looks like, but I'm used to go on being answered.
I cannot explain
it. This may not make sense.
I more of that. Come on, Brandon. Give me a little more of that. Give me a little more of that. Hallelujah.
Come on, your miracle is on the way. The song says, get ready, get it ready, get it ready. Say, your miracle is on the way. Come on and say, your miracle is on the way. Your miracle is on the way.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hey. Hallelujah.
Glory to your name, God.
You know, with all that's going on in the news, we need to sing songs like that. With all that's happening around us in the world, we the people of God, we need to be reminded that we're rolling with God and God is rolling with us. And this week is our week for miracles. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, thank you, Lord. Yeah, go on and praise Him. Go on and praise Him. Go on and praise Him. Go ahead. Go ahead. He's worthy of it. He's worthy of it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Everlasting. You are the everlasting. Yeah. Let's just worship for a few moments. Thank you, Lord.
Trust in you, God, yeah. I will trust in you.
Come on,
sing
the Lord, yeah.
Lord is my light and salvation.
Who shall
I
fear?
Who shall
I
be afraid?
wait on you, Lord.
I will wait on you.
I will trust in you.
I will trust in you.
I will trust in you.
You have won it all for me. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King. Seated in majesty, yeah. Hallelujah. You are the risen King, yeah. Come on, say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Come on, come on, come on. Let's bless him. Let's bless him. This is the house church. This is God's house. Let's bless him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. While you're standing, please locate for me Proverbs chapter 30. Locate Proverbs chapter 30 for me. God bless each and every one of you. Thank you for all of our visitors who are here with us. So many wonderful churches that you could have attended in this area, but we're so grateful that the Lord has saw fit for our paths to cross. Praise the Lord. What a wonderful worship. What a wonderful worship. Hallelujah. You know, when you come to church service and it's a worship service, I want you to always remember, House Church and all of our wonderful visitors, I want you to always remember, you're singing to an audience of one.
Yes, sir.
It's not about who's on your left, your right, in front of you, behind you, what this person got on, what that person don't have. It's not about none of that. I come to his house to worship him. I pray that when you come to my house, you're coming to see me. When I go to your house, I'm coming to see you. When you come to God's house, you should be coming to see him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. So locate Proverbs 30. Let me pray while you're finding that. Father, we give you praise, honor, and all the glory. What a wonderful worship service. Father, we trust and pray that you have been pleased with our worship of you this morning. Thank you for each and every person that's come from the north, south, east, and west of this holy location for one reason alone. That's to worship you in spirit and in truth and to receive from your holy word. So now I trust and pray that I have studied to show myself approved unto you, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed. May I rightly divide the word of truth this morning so that we as your people can have the right things operating in our hearts as well as in our lives. I do set a guard over my heart and a watch over my lips that I will not speak or say anything perverted or contrary to that which is sound doctrine or that which is written and contained within the holy word of God. But may the words that I share this morning with each of these, my precious, precious brothers and sisters in Christ, may they come forth with boldness, with power, with clarity, unhindered and unchecked by any demonic force. And Holy Spirit, we do say to you that you are the teacher of the church. And according to the word of God, you are the spirit of truth that leads us and guides us into all truths. So we back up this morning and give you your office space so that you can do this work. We ask that you would reveal another aspect or facet of the Lord Jesus Christ and his ministry unto us, the body of Christ. And may our lives never, ever be the same. We give you the praise, the honor, and all the glory. In the most holy, most precious, most immaculate name that there is, it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. And let us all shout together out loud, amen, amen. And amen. Amen. You all sound so wonderful this morning. Proverbs chapter 30, just locate this one verse, and we're using it as a launching pad for this series we started last week. Proverbs chapter 30, look at verse 24. I'm in the New King James Version. It says, there are four things which are little on the earth, but they are exceedingly wise. There are four things which are little on the earth, but they are exceedingly wise. Could you all read that in unison and very loudly, please? Go ahead. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. Thank you so much for standing throughout the worship and standing with me for the reading of the word of God. Praise God. Well, y'all ready to get after it? Let's get after it. Praise the Lord. We're continuing on our series entitled Tiny But Talented. Tiny But Talented. And I subtitled this series last week, Lessons Learned from the Animal and Insect Kingdom. Tiny But Talented. Lessons Learned from the Animal and Insect Kingdom. Last week we talked about the lesson from the ants. This morning's message is the lesson of the rock badgers. I like that name. Rock badgers or conies, and that message is foundation and fortification. Foundation and fortification. Say that with me. Foundation and fortification. One more time. Foundation and fortification. It was author Raquel Naomi Remen that said, and I quote, big messages come in small packages, end quote. Big messages come in small packages. Remember, I shared with us on last week when we started this series that God is the creator of the universe as we know, but we could take lessons from everything that God created. If we just take the time to watch the things that the Lord has created, there are lessons of wisdom and insight that you and I can gain from God's creation. One of the reasons for that is because God created everything through his wisdom. As a matter of fact, Psalms 104, verse 24 to 25 bears that out. It says, O Lord, how manifold are your works in wisdom. Everyone say in wisdom. In wisdom, you have made them all. Look at that. In wisdom, you have made them all. The earth is full of your possessions, this great and wide sea in which are innumerable teeming things, living things. Here's what I love, living things, both small and great. Both small and great. Tiny, but talented. You could also say small, but smart. You could even say little, and wise. Amen. Now, we shared last week that our pericope came from Proverbs chapter 30, and it's a very interesting chapter when you go back and look at it, because it was written by a man by the name of Agur. I gave this to you last week, but I want to reiterate just a few things before we jump off to what God has for us this morning. But this guy by the name of Agur actually wrote Proverbs chapter 30, and Agur's name is real interesting. His name means gathered, gatherer, or collector. That's real interesting, because Agur confesses himself in Proverbs chapter 30, verse 1. He talks about how he never spoke anything worth being wise. He talks about how he never said anything wise, but what he was a gatherer of wise sayings that he heard from other people. He collected wise sayings. And Proverbs chapter 30 is actually a collection that Agur put together of some wise sayings. Amen? I like what orator and author Booker T. Washington had to say. He said, and I quote, success in life is founded upon attention to the small things rather than to the large things, end quote. I like that. So now let's look at these four things that Agur found that was little and wise. Proverbs chapter 30, verse 24. Here's a part of his collection. Verse 24. There are four things which are little on the earth, but they are exceedingly wise. I like that, family. He didn't just say wise. He said they were exceedingly wise. There are four things which are little on the earth, but they are exceedingly wise. So now he enumerates, elder, these four things. The ants are a people not strong, yet they prepare their food in the summer. We learned that one last week. Here's where we are right now. Verse 26, the rock badgers are a feeble folk, yet they make their homes in the crags or in the rocks. Then he says, the locusts have no king, yet they all advance in ranks. And then verse 28 is interesting. The spider skillfully grasps with its hands, and it is in kings' palaces. So Agur lists in his writings, or his gathering of wise sayings, he collects this particular list right here. And I love this list. All the lists that he have are real interesting, and maybe one day we'll come back and we'll lift up the others, but the Lord wants us to highlight this one right now. He mentions four things. The first one is the ants in verse 25. Then he mentions the rock badgers. The word rock badger, it also means coney, okay? Verse 26. Then he talks about the locusts in verse 27. And then here's what's interesting, church. He mentions the spider, the spider. When you look it up in Hebrew, this word spider actually means lizard. It actually means lizard. Now, here's what's interesting, and I'm not going to get too far ahead of myself, but I absolutely love this. We learned last week that the message of the ant was preparation. Preparation. The ant doesn't wait till the last minute to prepare. While everyone else is enjoying their summer, the ant is busy working throughout the summer preparing for winter. Hallelujah. But then we have the rock badgers. I'm not going to give that one away. We're going to talk about it for a few seconds. Everyone say, talk about it. But then he says the locust. The message of the locust is unification. Unification. In other words, we are better together. I shared with you last week that if you see one locust by itself, 9 times out of 10, that's a rebellious locust. Because locusts, they swarm together in packs. And so there's a message that we can learn as the church from the locusts. That message is unification. We're better together. Look at someone and tell them, we're better together. And then I like this one, the spider or the lizard. The message of the spider and the lizard is stabilization. Stabilization. Remember I shared with you last week that the spider, as well as the lizard, has within its body this ability to secrete a sticky substance at the end of its legs. And so when it's walking, you hear, if you could hear it, it would sound like this. I like doing that. That's what it would sound like. And so a sub-message for the spider or the lizard is you got to have the stuff that sticks. Yeah, so many Christians don't have the stuff that sticks. They do all right when everything is all right. But when a little rain comes in your life, a little wind, a little waves, how do you handle it then? You have to have the stuff that stick. We'll talk about that later. Praise the Lord. Initially, the contrast between their size and skills calls for us to pay very close attention to what is about to be revealed concerning their behavior and how they operate. Remember, they are tiny, but they are wise. What I want to do, I want to jump right into what the message of the rock badger is. The lesson from the rock badger or the conies is foundation and fortification. Foundation. Ant's message was preparation. The conies message is foundation and fortification. We get that in verse 26. The rock badgers are a feeble folk. Man, I like that too. They are a feeble folk. Everyone say a feeble folk. Got to stop that. A feeble folk. There you go. The rock badgers are a feeble folk, yet, listen at this, they're feeble, yet they make their homes in the crags or in the rocks. Let me give you some information about a coney. How many of y'all know what a coney is? Wave your hand at me. Wave your hand at me. You know what a coney is, okay? What do you think a coney is? Let me hear it. Huh? Small rat? You say rat? Okay, what else? Rabbit? Huh? A rabbit and a rat. You took that thing to the lab, Elder. A rabbit and a rat. No, thank y'all for your honest answers, because that's what most of us think. I'm about to help us out, because I thought the same thing. That's not what a coney is. I think you're going to be blessed, all right? So listen at this. The conies, the rock badgers or conies, they're found across Africa and the Middle East. They are called hyrax in the scripture. Hyrax in the scripture. Let me show this to you. Leviticus chapter 11, verse 4 to 5. Leviticus 11, verse 4 to 5. This is when the Lord was giving them instructions about what to eat and what not to eat. And listen at this. Leviticus 11, 4 to 5. Nevertheless, these you shall not eat among those that chew the cud or those that have cloven hoofs. The camel, because it chews the cud but does not have cloven hoofs, is unclean to you. And then notice verse 5. The rock hyrax. Do y'all see that? The rock hyrax, that's the rock badger or the rock hyrax, because it chews the cud but does not have cloven hooves, is unclean to you. All right? So let me give you some more information, because I think this is going to bless you, because it definitely blessed me. When it comes to the rock badgers or the conies, their anatomy, now this is mind-blowing, their anatomy makes them pachyderms. Let me take y'all to school for a little bit. Pachyderms. Everyone say pachyderms. They are pachyderms. That pachyderm comes from two words. Pachys, which means thick. Derma, which means skin. So pachyderms means they are thick-skinned. Conies are thick-skinned. Rock badgers are thick-skinned. But listen at this. It doesn't stop there. Although smaller than their counterparts, rock badgers or conies are in close relations, oh my goodness, with the elephant and the rhinoceros due to the thickness of their skin. So that eliminates rabbit. And that eliminates rat. and that eliminates guinea pig. A rock badger or a coney, it has thick skin, and even though it's tiny, you guys, it's in the family. I thought that was mind-blowing. It's in the family of the elephant and the rhinoceros, two giant animals, and yet this is a small one but smart. They are gregarious. Gregarious means social creatures that live in colonies of up to 80 individuals. They grow up to 2 feet in length and weigh 10 pounds. Praise God. Although they look like guinea pigs and rabbits, they are a different species altogether. They are about the size of a well-grown rabbit with short ears, round head, long feet, no tail, and nails instead of claws. They have extremely weak teeth and short incisors. I think we have a couple of pictures. Do we have a couple of pictures for them? Go ahead and roll those pictures. Let's let everybody look at it. Look at this boy right here. Look at this boy right here. This is a coney. This is a coney. Look, he's in the rocks. Go ahead. Keep going. Look at that. They're on the rocks. And remember, we're supposed to learn a lesson from them. Look at that boy right there. Look at them. That's your coney. That's your coney. I like that boy right there. I had to include that picture. Go back to that one. That boy styling and profiling. Look at it. Look at that boy right there. Okay, go to the next one. Look at that. I can hear some people, oh, he's so cute. Look at that. In the rocks. Hallelujah. That's a rock badger or a coney. Okay? Thank you so much. Now here's what's interesting. They are without the means of self-defense and are vulnerable to attacks from all predators. This is why they live in the rock, all right? They are without means of self-defense. They have no way of defending themselves. There's no built-in defense mechanism on the inside of a coney when predators come. This is one reason, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but this is one reason why the conies live in the rocks. The conies have the ability to climb a 90-degree slope. And they get up high in the rocks and the little caves and caverns that the rocks have, they get up high and they make their nest in the rock. Do y'all hear some truth coming around the corner? Here's something else that's interesting. One of the Hebrew words for coney means the hiders. The hiders. I like that. Because they make their homes and they hide themselves in the rocks. A coney understands, my brother, that I don't want to get too far from the rock. Because if I get too far from the rock, now I'm vulnerable. And we are supposed to look at the conies because it's little and it's wise. It's tiny but talented. And we are supposed to learn a lesson from the coney. And the coney says, I can't get too far from the rock. Because if I get too far from the rock, now I'm out here on my own. I'm exposed with no means of defense. Psalms 104, verse 18, it says, the hills, the high hills are for the wild goats. The cliffs, listen at this, the cliffs are a refuge for the rock badgers. That's the coney. The cliffs are a refuge. The cliffs are a refuge. I love that. For the rock badgers. Do y'all see that? Read that verse out loud. Go ahead. One more time. Y'all sound wonderful. So what is the main lesson for us to learn from the rock badger this morning? For the next few moments, I'm so glad you asked. Here's the lesson of the rock badger or coney for us, church. The lesson of the rock badger or coney is foundation and fortification. Here it is. Build your life on the rock, Jesus Christ. Now, how come only four people shouted right there? Let me me try that again, because I know y'all in here. The lesson of the rock badger for us Christians and Conies is foundation and fortification. Here it is. Here's your second chance. Build your life on the rock, Jesus Christ. There you go. Build your life on the rock. Build your life on the rock. Build your life on the rock. Don't build your life on anything else but the rock, which is Jesus Christ. There was a song where it talks about on Christ the solid. God bless you, brother and sister boy. On Christ the solid rock I stand. But here's my part that I love. All other ground. Come on, mother. So what can we learn, mother, from the rock badger? The lesson is quite simple this morning. Build your life on the rock, Jesus Christ. Build your life on the rock. The lesson of the rock badger is for us to build our lives on the proper, everyone say proper, on the proper foundation. The word foundation, it means an underlying base or support on which something stands and is secured. I love that. An underlying base or support on which something stands and is secured. You know, it's always interesting that we don't place as much value on foundations as we should. I'm going to show you a scripture in just a few moments about the importance of foundations, but we don't really place a whole lot of value on foundations per se as we should. Oftentimes when we roll up on a nice building, we'll say, boy, that building looks good. Boy, that's a nice looking building. Man, look at that building. Man, ooh, that's a high building. No one takes time to praise the foundation. You ever thought about that? None of us, including me, none of us roll up on a building and say, ooh, look at that foundation. None of us, including me, when we roll up on a nice church, we don't say, whoa, look at the foundation. Just, boy, that's a nice church. Man, look at that. Whoa, that's a nice city hall building. Man, look at that. Man, that's a nice store. Look at that. That's a nice building. None of us praise the foundation. But the foundation is critical. Not only the foundation to a building, but the foundation to your life. Is critical. Foundations are critical. Can you say that? All right. And then the word fortification, because this is what we learn from the rock badger or the coney. Foundation and fortification. The word fortification, it means a structure of some kind. I love this, Lady L. A structure of some kind that serves as a defense. Beautiful. That serves as a defense against enemies, adversaries, or predators. Fortification is a structure of some kind that serves as a defense. Adversaries or predators. The rock badgers, they make their life, they build their home in the rock because they understand their weaknesses. There is no defense mechanism built into the coney. So the coney says, I'm going to need a little extra help defending myself. Since I can't do it on my own, I'm going to climb as high as I can and make my home in the rock. Because in order for my predators to get to me, they got to get through the rock. I'm going to show my age a little bit here, but there was a commercial years ago about Prudential. Get a piece of the rock. I know millennials don't know nothing about that commercial. Get a piece of the rock. Hallelujah. So fortification is a structure of some kind that serves as a defense. Say a defense. Against enemies, adversaries, or predators like walls and like mountains and like cliffs and rocks. Okay? So again, foundations are critical. Why, apostle, are foundations critical? Psalms 11, verse 3. Here it is, Psalms 11, verse 3. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? It was author Gordon B. Hinckley who said about foundations, and I quote, "You can't build a great building on a weak foundation. You must have a solid foundation if you're going to have a strong superstructure," end quote. Without a strong foundation, we are left to the whims and the devices. You know, the scriptures teach us that Jesus was talking to Peter, and he makes this statement to Peter. He says, Satan desires to have you, to sift you like wheat. He desires to have you, to sift you like wheat. He says, but I'm praying for you that when you've been strengthened, when you've been converted, you can go strengthen your brothers. Satan desires to have you. Now listen at that message, Carlos and Deb, that Jesus said to Peter, because that same message he gives to Peter, he's given to us as well. You just put your name in there. So I'll use me so you don't get offended. Johnny L. McGee Jr., Satan desires to have you so he can sift you as wheat, but I'm praying for you that when you're converted, you can go back and you can strengthen your brethren. Satan's sole job is to sift through our lives. Family, this is why your foundation is critical. This is why your foundation is critical. What are you building your marriage on? What are you building your finances on? What are you building your family on? What are you building your educational and employment pursuits on? You better make sure that you're building on the only solid rock that there is, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Foundation, fortification, something that serves as a defense. Well, the Lord is our defense. Multiple scriptures teaches us that. But I want to give you this quote from Prussian general Karl von Clausewitz. I like that, Karl von Clausewitz. And listen at this awesome quote. He said, and I quote, if you entrench yourself behind strong fortifications, here it is, you compel the enemy to seek a solution elsewhere. What that means, precious, is if your foundation is solid and if your fortification is the right person, which is Jesus Christ, then the adversary is going to have to seek a different solution elsewhere. Is it no wonder why the Bible teaches us that Satan walks about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, seeking whom he may devour. What do you think he's looking for? He's looking for those of us that don't have a solid foundation. None of us are immune to the storms of life. And contrary to popular belief, I'm gonna help us, storms do not come to make us stronger. I'm gonna help you this morning. We sing a lot of songs and it sounds good, but it's not scripturally sound. So storms don't come to make us stronger. Storms come to devastate you. Now, based on what you know in the midst of the storm, and based on who you know in the midst of the storm, it will help you get through it. But don't get it twisted. Storms don't come to make me strong. I think it's always interesting in church settings, you hear people say that, but that storm only came to make, no, it didn't. That storm came to devastate you. That storm arose in your life to destroy you. Thank God that you're still standing. All right, let me show you. A major thing that a storm does, here it is, family, a major thing that a storm does, it tests your foundation to see if your foundation is frail, feeble, fragile, faulty, or fragmented. Come on, daughter. That's why the storms in your life are rising up. None of us look for storms. Y'all help me. If y'all help me preach, I'll get you out of here early. Am I the only one that don't wake up every morning not looking for a storm? Am I the only one? When I wake up in the morning, I don't say, Lord, thank you for the storm. Lord, I'm looking for a storm today. No, that's not how I think. That's not, no, I'm not looking for a storm. Storms come. You just keep living, they coming. But you need to know why they coming. They're coming to destroy you. They're coming, here it is, put it back on the screen for them. A storm tests your foundation. I'm gonna give you a scripture. The storm tests your foundation to see if it is frail, what you building on, is feeble, what you're building on, is fragile, what you're building on, is faulty, and what you're building on is fragmented. Well, let's see it. Luke chapter 6, verse 47. Luke 6, verse 47. And here it is. Whoever comes to me and hears my saying, this is Jesus, and does them, I will show you whom he is like. Show us, Jesus. He is like a man building a house who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And here comes the storm. And when the flood arose, isn't that a storm? And the stream beat vehemently against that house, isn't that a part of a storm? And could not shake it. Couldn't shake it. Why couldn't it shake? For it was founded on the rock. The storm came, the floods, the rains, the winds beat on that house, but it didn't fall. It didn't shake. Why didn't it shake? Because of its foundation. It had the right foundation. But let's keep reading. But he who heard and did nothing, those of us that come to church, we hear the message every week, but we walk out and we don't do nothing with what we heard. But he who heard and did nothing is like a man who built a house on the earth, here it is, without a foundation, against which the stream beat vehemently, and immediately it fell. See, don't read too quick. And immediately it fell. And immediately it fell. And the ruin of that house was great. So now we have one storm and two houses and two different foundations. One storm, they both experienced the same exact storm, but one house withstood it and the other house fell. What was the difference? The foundation. The foundation. So, what are you building on this morning? What are you building your marriage on? What are you building that on? Lady L and I, we've been married 37 years. We're going on 38. Many of you have been married longer than us. We are on your heels. But our marriage, like you, our marriage is built on the right foundation. Our marriage is built on Jesus Christ. So as we grow and as we get older and we get more mature, not only is our marriage aging, but our marriage is getting more mature because it's founded on the rock. What are you building your financial status on? Is it your 401k? Is it your Social Security? Because the government done shut down a few times. Come on, talk back to me. So that can't be it. That's a faulty foundation. So we're going to have to put our trust in God and build on the right foundation. How are you raising your children? Are you letting television raise your children? Are you letting society raise your children? You letting Netflix raise your children and Prime television raise your children? Or are you building the right foundation in your children? Hallelujah. The Bible teaches us, train up a child in the way he should go. And when he's older, he will not depart from it. He'll depart from you, she'll depart from you, but they won't depart from the foundation that you laid in their hearts and lives. Oh, come on, give the Lord a hand of praise right there. Glory to God. Glory to God. All right, let me give you two more quotes and we're going to move on. This former Ethiopian leader, Haile Selassie, he said about foundations, and I quote, "A house built on granite and strong foundations, not even the onslaught of pouring rain, gushing torrents, and strong winds will be able to pull it down." I love that. And then let me give you this quote from one of my favorite people in all the world, besides my wife, one of my favorite people is from this gentleman by the name of Apostle Nathaniel Holcomb. My father in the faith, who's gone home to be with the Lord. My father in the faith said, and I quote, "We may tremble on the rock, but the rock never trembles under us." End quote. See, there's times when we're going through storms and we're going through things and it causes us, Dad and Mom Speller, it causes us to tremble because it catches us off guard. We wasn't looking for it. Maybe something happened on the job and now we gotta look at relocating and getting a new job. Maybe something happened with a loved one. Maybe there was an unexpected death of a loved one or an unexpected illness of a loved one. All type of things. We get negative news about our children. All type of stuff. These things come and they catch us off guard. And sometimes, as my father in the faith taught us years ago, sometimes we may tremble on the rock, but thank God, the rock of Jesus Christ never trembles under me. Hallelujah. And so as the rock badger understands that it is vulnerable and indefensible while away from its rock formations, we as God's people must realize that the further away we get from Jesus through our lack of devotion, lack of daily reading the word, lack of studying the word, lack of prayer, lack of fellowshipping with God, we become more exposed and vulnerable to the attacks mentally, emotionally, physically, psychologically, and spiritually of our adversary. You've gotten further away from the rock. Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 3 to 4. Listen at this. Jesus is our rock. Deuteronomy 32, verse 3 to 4. For I proclaim the name of the Lord. Ascribe greatness to our God. Verse 4, He is the rock. He is the rock. His work is perfect, for all His ways are just. A God of truth and without injustice, righteous and upright is He. He's the rock. He's the rock. He's the rock. But listen at this, Ephesians chapter 2. Come on, travel quickly. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. Now therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Here's my favorite part of the text. Jesus Christ Himself being the chief cornerstone. He's the chief cornerstone. Now, I've shared this before in our Bible school. I've shared this before, but let me reiterate this. That word cornerstone, when you do a thorough research, it also means coping stone, or a master stone when it comes to masonry. The cornerstone is the first stone, and its dimensions on every side, daughter, is perfect. It's perfect. And so when building a structure, they would start with the cornerstone, and the cornerstone would set the pace or the direction that the structure was to go in. But also what they used to do back in first century Palestine, they would cut all their other stones from that one, Derek, they would cut all their other stones from that one master stone. They would cut it because it was perfect in its dimensions, and they would build that way. But here's what happens. If you cut a stone from the original, then you cut another stone from the copy, then you cut another stone from the copy of the copy, then you cut another stone from the copy, from the copy, from the copy, then you cut another stone from that copy that you copied from that copy that you copied from that copy and that you copied from that copy. And then you cut another stone from the copy that you copied from that 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 copy. Look how far away you're getting from the original. And that's how many Christians are. That's how many churches are. We are building away from the original. We're doing our own thing. And Jesus is the chief cornerstone. So the further away I get from the cornerstone, I start to look nothing like Him. If I was to ask you to go make me a copy, Xerox me a copy of something of this, I just gave you the master or the original. You make a copy from that, and then you start burning other copies from that copy. What's going to happen? It's going to start getting faded. But the original is still crisp and clear. First Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1 to 5. We're just about there. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1 to 5, because this is the lesson of the Coney. Build your life on the rock, Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 1 to 5. Moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that all our fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea, all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. All ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. I love this. For they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them. And that rock was Christ. But with most of them, God was not well pleased, for their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now, before we get ready to go home, you got to really understand this text right here. Remember when God led the children of Israel out of Egypt? We are all familiar with he led them by a pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. We're all familiar with he rained down, my brother, quail for them to eat and manna every day for them to eat. We're all familiar with that, but here's something we lose sight of. We lose sight of the fact that God told Moses on one occasion to speak to a rock so that they could receive water and refreshments. He told Moses, speak to the rock so they could receive water and refreshment. Now, here's what's awesome with this text we just read. God is leading them out of Egypt with a pillar of cloud during the daytime. He's leading them at night with a pillar of fire. He's feeding them manna every day, got quails blowing in. And this giant rock, my brother, is following them. Did y'all just hear what I said? Did y'all see it in the scripture? This giant rock is following them. Pillar of cloud today, fire by night, and they got this giant boulder rolling with them everywhere they go. They stop, the boulder stop. God tells Moses, speak to it, it'll give you water. They pack up, they leave, the boulder start rolling with them. They stop, set up tent, and God says, Moses, speak to the rock, it'll give you water. They break down, they set up, they leave again, and this rock is following them. Remember I taught you in the series dealing with the Feast of the Lord that everything in the Old Testament is types and shadows. That rock that followed them was a type of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So verse 4, and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them. And that rock was Christ. So we see here in Tiny But Talented, lessons learned from the animal and insect kingdom, foundation and fortification. That's the lesson of the rock badgers. And the conies, foundation and fortification. One more time, Proverbs chapter 30, verse 24. There are four things which are little on the earth, but they are exceedingly wise. The ants are a people not strong, yet they prepare their food in the summer. Wonderful. That's preparation. The rock badgers or coney are a feeble folk, yet they make their homes in the crags. Foundation and fortification. The locusts have no king, yet they all advance in ranks. Unification. The spider skillfully grasps with its hands and it's in king's palaces. Stabilization. And so I pray that each and every one of us have been blessed by that this morning, and that you will begin to make sure, praise the Lord, and that you will begin to make sure that your life is being built on the proper foundation. The lesson of the rock badger is foundation and fortification. Build your life on the rock, Jesus Christ. I want to give you this last quote. You've been so wonderful this morning. This last quote from David Allen Coe, who is a songwriter. He said, and I quote, "It is not the beauty of a building you should look at. It's the construction of the foundation that will stand the test of time." End quote. Build on the rock, the Lord Jesus Christ. Build on the rock, the Lord Jesus Christ. Come on, stand to your feet. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Storms come, family, to test your foundation. And if your foundation is faulty, if your foundation is frail, if your foundation is feeble, if your foundation is fragmented, then it's not the proper foundation. All of us will encounter storms in life. All of us will encounter things that were unexpected that would catch us off guard. But thank God that our lives are built on the rock, the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we just give you praise and we give you honor and all the glory. Again, we thank you for our time together and a time with my brothers and sisters in Christ. And I trust and pray in all my human frailty, I was able to convey your heart and your mind unto us today. We're grateful for this lesson that we learned from one of your creatures, tiny but talented, the rock badger, the coney, who makes its home in the rock, who knows that it's defenseless away from the rock. You said that it's small but exceedingly wise. What a wise creature that is. Lord, I pray that all of us have learned a lesson, this vital lesson, that we too are to stay in the rock. We're to stay close to you so that you become our fortress, that you are our fortification. You are our foundation. We give you the praise and we give you the honor and we give you all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. Hallelujah. Simple lesson from the rock badger. Praise the Lord. Look at three people and tell them, build their life, build your life on the rock. Build your life on the rock. Build your life on the rock. Praise the Lord. Come on, elder. Praise the Lord. Build your life on the rock. Praise God. Praise God. Man, I was excited about that message. Man, that thing blessed me all week. I was chewing on it, Carlos, all week, man. Yeah, praise God. Praise God. That was just for you? Praise God. It was for me, too. It's for me, too. Praise the Lord. I thank God for these messages, these lessons that we can learn from these small animals. Come on, let's pray right quick, and then I'm going to turn it over to our elders who are going to close out the service. Again, Lord, we just thank you. We give you praise. We give you honor. I pray for each and every person that's present that their life will never be the same. Thank you, Lord, for touching all of us this morning with the simplicity of your word. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give the Longs a hand of praise.
Hallelujah. There we go. Foundation and fortification. Simple, isn't it? That's all we got to do. Okay, I got it. Okay. So before we close out, we want to have all the children come up right quick, and we're going to pray for them and before they go to school on next week and in the weeks ahead.
Also,
and Elder Mack, if you could help the kind of help organize them here in the front.
Also, we want to keep the boys lifted in prayer. Understand that Deaconess was admitted to the hospital this morning, and we want to keep her lifted in prayer. We know that prayer works. God is able. It caught us off guard. Didn't catch him off guard.
Amen.
And we want to make sure that we are united in prayer for them and for brother and sister DePaul. I think they had some family members that transitioned this weekend. And so, you know, it's a lot. It doesn't look good. It doesn't feel good. But we know that we are still God's, you know, and he's got us. Yep. He's got us. And we pray that they were born again, believe that they were born again, and that they will see them again. Okay, so we are not sorrow as others who have no hope. We have a hope in Jesus, in that rock
Amen.
That we just heard about. Amen?
Amen. Man. Any other students going back to college, you can come for it too if you like. Yeah. And we're not going to lay hands on them because of the season that we're in. But we will pray for them. And if everybody can just lift your hands towards the children as we pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you this morning for Psalm 91 being with each and every one of these children, Father God. We thank you, Father God, for covering them during this upcoming weeks of returning back to school, Father God. We ask you for your hedge protection around them during this COVID season, and that we bind up any attack against them, Father God, whether it be from COVID or whether it be from the variant or either the flu, Father God. We thank you for protecting their little bodies, Father. And Lord, we thank you, as Pastor had already shared with us, that we have victory over the variant, so we need concerned with that. Father God, we just thank you for continuing to cover them and for opening doors of opportunity for them, Father God, and showing favor to them as they enter the next school year. And we thank you, Father God, that each of the students, Father God, will treat their classmates with respect and honor, Father God, that they will be mindful of who they are and where they are in Christ and their vocation, Father. Lord, we thank you for the parents, Father God, that are praying for these children every day, Father. Whether they be parents, Father God, bonus parents, grandparents, whoever it is that is setting up that godly home for them, Father God, we keep them lifted up and keep them in strength and in your favor as well. And Lord, as they prepare to go back to class, Father God, we thank you for binding up any attack that the adversary may have, anything that they have assigned to them, Father God, that we cancel every attack, everything that they may be facing, Father God. And we lift them up this morning, and we thank you for just a blessed year for each and every one of them. And Lord, we just thank you for your love and your grace, Father. And now, Heavenly Father, as we prepare to leave this place, but never your presence, that we bind up any accidents, any engine troubles, Father God, anything that will keep people from, anything that the adversary would try to use to steal this word of foundation and fortification on today, Father God, that would carry us throughout the remainder of this week. And Father God, we thank you for traveling mercies for each and every one. We thank you for just blessing them on today, Father God, until we return back here on Wednesday night, Father God, at 7 p.m. And Lord, we thank you for all these things, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
You are dismissed.